Hence, if he doesn't give, I'm pulling. If he gives, I'm drawing. He can see the need to have a horse that can give his nose, but he can soon see the foolishness of locking it in a place. He's got to use his nose to compensate his bum or to equalise his bum. He needs lateral flexion and he needs to lift and lower his head. Hang on, buddy. Hang on. He needs to be able to lift and lower his head if I'm going to change the shapes of his body. Make sense? You change his posture by being able to manipulate his head laterally and horizontally. If I was going to lift his head, my hands would come forward. If I was going to lift his shoulders, my hands would stay back and lift. Look at the reins and the bit like a long stem box, long stem rose box. If I wanted to turn him, I'd need to swing the box. If I wanted to move his shoulder, I'd just pick this end of the box up and place it over there. Make sense? If I wanted to push his head down, I'd push that end of the box down. If I wanted to lift it, I'd need to lift that end of the box. If I wanted to move sideways, I'd keep the box straight and slide it sideways. Think about that box. Your shoulders and hands talk to the front legs. Your hips and legs talk to the back legs. I need my shoulder control because one day I'm going to do some cowboy dressage and you're expected to ride in on a straight line. You can't straighten the horse by shifting his back end, but you can ride his hind quarters straight and then move his shoulders to get his front legs in line with his back legs. When I ask him to stop, if I stop him with my hips and I walk his front legs into the stop, but if I pull on the reins to stop him, I'm committed to whatever step he stopped in. Make sense? I can walk his front legs wherever I want him. If I need him to back up, I can collapse his ribs, collapse his girth, and draw that leg. If I want him to step forward, I collapse his girth and push that leg. Draw that leg. Push that leg. It hasn't got much to do with squeezing them in the middle. If you squeeze them in the middle, it's like squeezing a tube of toothpaste. The toothpaste goes two directions. I need to squeeze the toothpaste out of his head to go forward, and I need to bring the toothpaste back into the tube to go backwards. If you let too much toothpaste go out the front, you won't get some back sometimes. So be careful of that. Make sense, guys? Mm-hmm. Just like on the ground with that horse, we're just working on the bits of the horse. Your horse isn't stuck in his whole body, he's stuck in bits. For instance, if this leg was further forward and he refused to go, and that's the stuck leg, not that one. If he refused to back up, I need to shift that leg, then that leg, then that leg. Then, when he got his shoulders off, now I can talk to him about his hocks. Stop in the nose. When I widen my hands, that's his cue to break at the wither. When I keep my hands together, that's his cue to break at the pole. Stand his shoulder up and release his legs. He's doing pretty good, huh? He gets a little cranky sometimes, but I think that's only stuck muscles. I think he'd be a animal. He does have some baggage, but that's all right. That's all right. And I ask you to move. He should listen to the life in my body. But if I was going to ask him to walk slow, he should. He should lead with his nose, but he should steer his shoulder. Now walk a little quicker. Stop. Get your head down and stop. Forward. Can't use your bum with your head over. He's a little bit behind the vertical there. That means I've got to get a little softer in my hands, eh? Can't get too much softer. Maybe I've just got to add more leg and push his nose forward a little bit. Got the idea? If I push on him, I can push his nose out just a bit. He should learn to flex. Look where you're going to go. Don't move yet. Look where you're going to go. Now go where you're looking. He shouldn't move just because I pick up the rein. When I pick up the rein, that says look. When I push with the other rein or my foot, that says go. If I use my legs, I cause the bottom of the horse to go first. If I use my reins, I cause the top of the horse to go first. And that's what makes horses drop the shoulder. When we tip ourselves into the turn, they have to tip their head to the other side to upset our balance, and then they leave the shoulder. Horses that drop their shoulder laterally also drop their shoulder forward. If you ride your horse like you're pushing the wheelbarrow, they'll turn in the wheelbarrow. Make sense? If you ride your horse like you're going uphill, then they'll go uphill. Quarter horses aren't real pretty moving horses until you do something about them from the front. They can move real pretty when they get their shoulders up. All horses are pretty when their shoulders are up. Makes sense? Those shoulders. When I pick him up, I need him to gather himself up there. He's got to get a little higher in the front. And then he can get restless, and then go. When I ask him to come around my corner, let's say I want a 10-metre circle, I've got choices. I can either take his shoulder out with my outside rein, or I can take his ribs out with my outside leg. My outside rein will take his shoulder deeper into the corner and then straighten it. My outside leg will take his ribs deeper into the corner and then straighten it. Your outside leg's got a lot more to do than pushing on a horse. Your outside leg might dictate some of the bend. Draw his ribs out and then shut the ribs. If I want him to turn to the left, I want his ribs on the right before I start turning left. If I want him to turn to the right, I need his ribs on the left before I start turning. Otherwise, he'll start doing this and dropping his shoulder through his turn. But if he keeps the weight on the outside of his body, he's going to be able to make that turn. If I want to make a smaller turn, I need to lift the shoulders up. If I want to make a bigger turn, put the shoulders down. Make sense, guys? The higher his shoulder, the smaller the turn. lower his shoulder, but he can see. He can see the need to be able to lift and lower his shoulder. He can see the need to be able to lift and lower his head. He can see the need to be able to bend the head laterally, because you can't shape the body without being able to supple that head. And horses that are stiff in the neck never have soft front legs. Horses that are stiff in the pole never have soft back legs. Without that pole being open, I can't get to his hocks. I can't get to his fetlocks, I can't get to his back feet. I can force his head into a shape, but that still won't let me get to his back legs. He has to give that. Pick up that belly and let him stretch forward through his head. And as he stretches forward through his head, then his nose will come soft. Can you see that? He reaches that way to give there, never this way. And I never want my horse to look like a turtle. The stallion walks out and says, "Poor girls are here." Can't see much point in that. He stretches the top line to bring his wheelbase together. If I was to ask him to do a freestyle turn, hind quarter turn, or turn on the forehead, I could do lots of circles. But if I was going to gather him up, I can't afford to do much more than a half turn, because right there, every step brings his back legs closer to his front legs, so there'll be a point where he has to move his front legs and you'll go cricketing for it. Make sense? Every time he steps this leg under his belly in front of the other, his wheelbase gets shorter. So if I was in collection, I'd probably only be looking to do half turns. But if I was in freestyle, I'd let him do as many as I wanted. Because the extra bend in his body keeps him more supple than he'll stride. He won't bring his wheelbase so close. Make sense? Try then. Pick him up. Shoot my guns. Turn all my guns, my toes, my fingers, and shoot head. The part that leans against the horse is the bit that gets the rhythm. Start to fall forward, throw your shoulders back and hold him on his back edge with your shoulders. That's not a turnaround, that's a sidestep. The difference is that was more a lateral step, where a turnaround is a forward motion. That's a turn. That's a sidestep. Both are useful, but my horse needs to learn to go forward in his turns. All turns really go forward in all front end turns. What else? He's doing pretty good after a couple of days. He's doing real good. If I lift his belly, I'd like him not to step forward first. He should think posture. Posture. Posture, no. Posture. Posture, no. Posture. Good. Now performance. Make sense, guys? He shouldn't move before he thinks about shape. He should think shape. Now go. If I can get him to give his nose, he's going to give me a heck of a lot more in the back end. Especially if I haven't locked his head. He's got to put it there, and the more I push with my legs, the more he's got to learn to hold it down. So I can actually hold his head there with my inside leg. When my horse learns to turn good, I should be able to relinquish my inside rein. suicide rains are the affliction rain, it's not a turning rain. But at first, you've got to use that inside rein and pretty much flower rein your horse to teach him to use his inside leg. Once he's got it, then it takes two reins to make the turn. That's the front end. Now the back end. Not backwards. Relax. I've just worried him. See his ears? I've just worried him. We'll give him a moment. Good. Now we'll do all four legs. Maybe not. There we go. Front and back legs. Get too rattled, you're all right. He's not used to too much pressure without stressing. He's not used to having lots of pressure without having to protect himself or fight himself. So to put a little bit of pressure on him isn't a bad thing, but it's got to be measured to the point where he can handle it. And then I can ask him to be my performance horse. When you ask Roger performance horse, he has to handle pressure. But pressure should be positive. He should think pressure means try, not pressure means you're in trouble. This horse thinks pressure means he's in trouble. Mm. Make sense? Mm. If I get after him, he will chuckle wobbly. Yeah, for good reason. Philly says, that's what I did last time. Mm. I think I fell over, did I hear you say?
Yeah. And pulled over.
Well, maybe it was an accident. That's about it, guys. The step after that is just about where we're at with this concept of lateral flex. It's all concept. There's nothing said in concrete. Stand still like that. The concept of indirect rein. Indirect means back end. The concept is direct rein. Inside is rein for the inside foot, and then inside rein for the outside. Outside rein for the outside foot. One day, I'm going to talk to him about being a little slack off the outside rein. When that outside rein touches him, he shouldn't be there. But if they've been hung on to, they lose that real quick. It should act almost like an electric fence. When that rein touches, he should be over there. Like this. It's a support rein. Outside rein's an interesting thing. If I hold it and then give a little, I'm talking to the right back leg. Now if I hold that rein, I'm holding the right back leg. If I pull backwards on it, I'm telling the right back leg to step backwards. It makes a joke out of that idea of that we should lock the outside rein. Your inside rein talks to the inside leg as a direct rein. The outside back leg as an indirect rein. An active support rein, the outside rein talks to the outside front leg, and as a standing support rein, it talks to the inside back leg. Each rein has two feet to talk to. Make sense? Each rein talks to two feet, and usually two diagonal feet. Ask him to back up. Right leg. He backs off my hands. He backs off my feet. He backs off a combination. Ask him to walk forward. Tell the right leg, then the left leg to go. Ask him to stop. Tell one leg to stop, then the other. I wouldn't want to pull those legs to a stop at the same time, would I? If I was using my reins. Tell one leg to go, then the other. You start to relax a little bit now. All that was done with the test horse. He's doing okay. Now, go to your quiet place. Go to your quiet place. There you go. That's where I tell my horse to go if he gets bothered. If he really gets bothered, I'll take his head, but I don't do that very often and I don't want to do it too much. I'll control rate, you take his head, you don't care about lateral flexion. Lateral flexion, you do care about lateral flexion, so you've got to use your foot. Balance. Balance. As I turn my right toe, he turns his nose. As I turn my left toe, he turns his nose. If I wanted to straighten him, I'd use my right leg. And I wrap it. He did pretty good. Hope that gives you some idea of where we're going with our horsemanship. The concept of the ground skills, we just take the ground skills up onto their back. Ground skill one, lateral bend. So when you get on, ground skill one. Ground skill two, use the feel. So when we get on, ground skill two. Teaching a horse to move off your leg. I put my leg on and he takes it off. Make sense? I don't hold my leg for 2 steps or 3 steps or 10 steps. I put it on 10 times if I want 10 steps. Because rhythm's the only thing your horse has got in his life that he can get along with you. Make sense? Rhythm is how he lives, how he moves. You can change his rhythm, but you can't really change his conformation. His posture is your fault. His good posture is your fault. His bad posture is your fault. And that changes moment to moment. And that's pretty much hooked onto his emotion. Every stride he takes is a product of his emotion. If you ride, when you ride your horse, if you're riding a lazy horse, as he gets stronger, you strengthen his laziness. Laziness is a resistance. It's a defense. You shouldn't just look at it and say, it's lazy. Lazy gets killed more than the wild horse will. Because you don't know where it's going to come unforked. Quiet, when you rock and rattle their cage, they just do more, and when they stop, they go do less. Lazy, they resist forward movement, and then when you get after them, they become reactive. Got the idea? So many of us mistake a lazy horse with a quiet horse. A lazy horse is not a quiet horse. He's just not lit up yet. He hasn't thrown himself away. If your horse is a nail biter, if you ride him as a nail biter, he'll strengthen his muscles and strengthen to hold his nail biter, his nervous system. Okay? Whatever your horse's primary emotion is, as he gets fitter, you strengthen that emotion. So if you want your horse to be alright, you've got to make him alright, then get him fit to hold on to the alright. Alright's a funny word, but it's the only one I use these days when I want to describe a good horse. I just want him to be alright. You take that where you want. And that needs some basket case. My horses are my signature, and I don't want to get a reputation because of what my horse does wrong. I want to get a reputation of what my horse did right. I don't mind riding a young horse. I don't mind riding an inexperienced horse or an untrained horse. But I won't ride an idiot. Idiot's a man-made. I hope that helped you a little bit, guys, with the idea of horses and horsemanship. This isn't the only way, it's the way I use it. If you've got another way that works for you, that's great. Probably the best idea is do what you do, have fun, and leave your horse with his dignity when he's done. He didn't ask to do our rubbish. put him there that we need to look out for.
Good luck to you guys. Thank you very much.